You're listening to the Nutrition Experts Podcast, featuring guests who take the scientific talk about food and break it down for practical use. You've heard the phrase, you are what you eat. Come find out what that really means. Experience conversations with experts in the field of nutrition and understand the power of food for our health, well-being, and beyond. Now, here's your host, registered dietitian and nutritionist, Mathea Ford.
Hey there, it's Mathea. Welcome back to the Nutrition Experts Podcast, the podcast featuring nutrition experts who are leading the way. Using Food starts today, right now, with our next guest. It's great to have Jessica Spiro on the show today. Jessica, welcome to Nutrition Experts.
Thank you so much for having me on your show.
I'm excited to have you on the show and share your expertise with my tribe. So, Jessica, let's start out with letting you tell my listeners a little more about you and what you do.
Yeah, so I'm a registered dietitian. I'm based in San Diego, and I specialize in vegan and vegetarian nutrition for kids, so plant-based diets for children. And I decided to go into this specific area because of my own personal experience. So I had a daughter 2 years ago, and I was basically mostly vegetarian since probably I was 12 years old. And then when she started eating, I found out she was allergic to milk and eggs. So I started to research more and more about vegan diets, mainly because I was trying to look up recipes and also make sure that she was getting her adequate nutrition and calcium and all of that. And I was, one, learning more about veganism and the ethical aspects of that really resonated with me. And in addition, I also found that there was a big gap in information. So there's really not much information pertaining to specific nutritional needs for vegan children in particular. And so I felt that being a registered dietitian and also having my own personal experience trying to look for that information, I decided to go into that area.
You mentioned the ethical aspects of vegetarian, vegan foods. What would be some examples of that?
So in terms of a plant-based diet, is really where you're incorporating more fruits and vegetables, you're eating predominantly plant-based sources of proteins, et cetera. Veganism is, it encompasses the ethical aspects, including, you know, just your everyday living, including, you know, not buying leather products and things like that. So vegans omit any type of animal products. So dairy, eggs, you know, things like honey, for example. There's specific nutrient needs that, you know, we need to pay extra attention to, especially if we're raising vegan children.
So the ethical side is really just not using animal products. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay. So would you say that children that you work with seem to find that extra value, or they're inspired by that, or is it something that is different for kids?
You know, interestingly enough, I thought it was going to be a lot of parents coming to me because they decided to go vegan and wanted to get their family on board. But actually, it's been a lot of times that I'll have moms reach out to me because their child wants to go vegan. They were impacted by a story that they heard. And so their families want to support them and their beliefs and want to, of course, make sure that they're providing them adequate nutrition.
What age typically are you working with kids when they're kind of making these choices?
If parents aren't already raising them from a young age, it's usually preteen teenagers that I find. I don't know if that's like, you know, the, you know, statistics, of course, but that's just generally what I've seen in my practice.
So let's talk for a minute because you specialize in plant-based nutrition for kids. Can you talk about what is plant-based nutrition? Is it the same as a vegetarian diet? And is vegetarian the same as vegan? Or is plant-based nutrition, which one is, how are they different?
Yeah, so plant-based, there is no legal definition for plant-based, but most people assume it to mean a diet where the majority of your nutrition is coming from plants. So, you know, I love the label plant-based, but really it's actually what dietitians have been recommending since forever, really, where we should be eating more fruits and vegetables, more whole grains, and perhaps little to you know, or maybe less on the, you know, processed meats, things like that. So eating more fruits and vegetables and more grains is probably, you know, at the epicenter of the diets. And then veganism takes it another step because it encompasses more of the ethical aspects that I was talked about before. So, you know, vegans don't necessarily have to be plant-based. So there's vegan alternatives to almost every type of food. And it doesn't, of course, doesn't necessarily mean it is healthy. So, you know, you can do vegan nuggets, for example, you can do vegan macaroni and cheese. So veganism is about the ethical component, the animal welfare, as well as environmental impact of our eating habits. And plant-based is more focused on the diet and the health aspects of it. And of course, people can be both or, you know, a combination. And vegetarianism, there's different components of vegetarians. So vegetarians typically eat, like lacto-ovo eats milk and eggs, and pescatarians include fish in their diets. And then, of course, there's varying degrees and of each. People might not be all vegan, they might be mostly vegan, or, you know, things like that. So, but those are pretty much the definitions.
So plant-based doesn't necessarily mean that you're not eating meat. It just means that the majority of your food, 80-90%, is plant-based, and you may have some meat products or other chicken, that type of stuff every now and then.
Exactly.
Okay. What type of meat substitutes do vegans usually eat, or, you know, to get, I'm guessing, protein and other components that we typically get out of meat?
So in terms of, like, if you're talking about the vegan alternatives that you can buy, sort of more processed versions, they're going to typically be soy. That's the most common one that you'll see. But in terms of finding vegan replacements to protein, so, well, first, you know, all plant foods do have protein. You know, whole grains have protein, and pasta has protein. All those foods do have varying degrees of protein. But typically a protein replacement on your plate, for example, would look like more like beans, for example, tofu, even nuts and seeds. So a lot of people make, and I do this at home too, I make my own vegan cheese using soaked cashews, a little bit of nutritional yeast. And so there's ways that you can kind of give that cheesiness without necessarily having to buy one at the grocery store, a alternative. So, but typically the replacements are going to be those proteins and legumes and nuts, seeds, things like that.
So I've heard of nutritional yeast, but I have no idea what it is or how you would use it or how it enhances food. So can you talk about nutritional yeast?
So nutritional yeast has a little bit of a cheesy flavor. So it's a really great way to add a little bit of that flavor to foods, especially when you're, you know, trying to get things more palatable for children. But it's also a fortified source of B12, which we know in vegan diets, it's the number one nutrient that vegans need to supplement in their diet, because you cannot get B12. And in your diet other than through meat or meat products or animal products rather.
So what exactly is nutritional yeast? Is it like a yeast or?
Yes, exactly. And it comes in flake form. So, and a lot of people don't really like it's a divide. It's almost like cilantro. I find that 50% of people really like it and 50% of people can't stand it. So I hear a lot about it, of course, in vegan diets, but it's not a necessity. You don't, to be vegan, you don't necessarily have to have nutritional yeast, but it's just an easy way to add a little bit of that cheesy flavor to sauces and things like that.
Interesting. So you just put it in kind of a little bit and...
Yeah, you mix it in sauces. Some people just top it, just, you know, sprinkle some on the topping of pasta or any other kinds of dips. You can really, if you go online, there's tons of recipes that where you can use it. And again, it's a really great way to make sure you're fortifying your diet with B12.
What are the risks for kids being raised on a plant-based diet or a vegetarian diet? Are there certain nutrients they need to supplement? Are there certain things that they do differently versus an adult?
There's definitely a lot of benefits of eating a plant-based diet. People that follow plant-based diets have lower incidences of cancer, heart disease, and lower BMIs overall. So But there are some concerns. There are some nutritional nutrients that vegans do need to pay attention to. So B12, as I mentioned, is the number one because it can't be met through the diet. So actually, interestingly enough, B12 is a bacteria. In the past, we got it through our diet because we didn't have, you know, clean water. We ate food maybe from the ground. And thank goodness we now have clean water, so we cannot get it through our diet. So that means we do have to have it fortified. And animals get it through eating, you know, from the ground or wherever. So, and so then we in turn get it from the animals. So people that follow a vegan diet do need to supplement. And this is really key for children, especially. So especially if you're starting them off on vegan diets at young ages, vegan B12 stores last in our bodies for about 5 to 7 years. So someone, an adult who may have gone vegan later on in life, it's really important not to have a kind of a casual attitude about B12. B12 deficiency does exist in people who follow vegan diets. And so it's really important to supplement. And for children who might not have had developed those stores, deficiency can happen very quickly. And those deficiency can lead to issues with your nerves, cognitive function, et cetera. It's an incredibly important nutrient to get in your diet. You can get it through fortified foods. So cereals, plant-based milks, not all of them. So you definitely want to check the labels. But they'll typically have B12. They'll be fortified with B12. That's not a reliable source because, you know, with children especially, it's hard. You know, they don't always eat their full bowl of oatmeal. They don't always drink, you know, that glass of milk might go half drinking the whole day. So it's important to supplement. And I recommend people, you know, work with their doctor, dietitian to find out, you know, how much to supplements, or you can go to the, you know, look up where the dietary reference, the DRIs for those nutrients and make sure you're supplementing.
So are there any other nutrients? Do they ever worry about iron or, you know, vitamin D, anything like that?
Yes. So iron and vitamin D are nutrients that really we should, that vegetarians, vegans, and people that follow, you know, just regular omni diets, as they call them, they, we're all, iron is a nutrient that we can typically be lacking in all of our diets. So, so vegans, they're not getting the heme iron. So it's recommended the heme iron that's found in beef, for example, is considered to be better absorbed than non-heme iron found in beans. So it's generally recommended to have about double the iron. And that's pretty easy to get in a vegan diet if it's well planned. So a cup of beans, for example, is going to have about 6 to 7 milligrams of iron. And that's actually almost double the amount that you're going to find in a 3 ounce serving of beef. So you can get a lot of iron through the diet if you make sure to have beans in your food. Also, tofu also has iron. So it's those are some easy ways to get iron in the diet. And as for vitamin D, as we know, it's a sunshine vitamin. It's a hormone that, you know, now that we want to make sure that we have proper sunscreen, or if you're living in colder climates, of course, we can all be deficient in vitamin D. It's fortified in milk. In cow's milk. So that's how most kids are getting their vitamin D. So it, likewise, it's also fortified in a lot of in plant milks as well. So that's some ways that you can get vitamin D and make sure that you're getting adequate amounts.
Okay, great. I know that the AND, American Nutrition Dietetics Group, and they have a position statement on the appropriateness of a vegan or vegetarian diet, and they say it's appropriate for all ages. So what reasons do parents, you mentioned that parents, you know, often bring their kids because they've, the kids have decided they want to be vegan, but what reasons do parents have for wanting to do like a plant-based diet with their kids?
So yes, I'm glad you mentioned the Academy of Nutrition Dietetics, their statement, their position statement on vegan vegetarian diets. They said that it's safe for all stages of life, from infancy, pregnancy, breastfeeding. Of course, they added a key element to that position statement, which is well-planned. So a well-planned vegan and vegetarian diet are safe, and it's not only safe and adequate, it also has a lot of health benefits as well in reducing the occurrence of chronic diseases. So in terms of parents deciding to go more plant-based, you hear about it a lot more. There's a lot more research that's coming out on plant-based diets. So, you know, I'd love to reference a particular study or group of studies that they did on the Seventh-day Adventists. It's one of the most cited studies for people that follow vegan and vegetarian or plant-based diets. And it's actually one of the largest studies looking into the health benefits of plant-based diets. And basically, there's a large concentration of Seventh-day Adventists in Loma Linda, California, where people follow healthy vegan and vegetarian diets for religious reasons. It was funded by the National Cancer Institute, and the last one had over 95,000 people and over a period of time. And what they found was there was significant health benefits and of following those diets, including, for example, a 70% reduction in lung cancer, even compared to non-smokers eating a standard American diet. They also found that the Adventists who ate legumes at least a couple of times a week had about a 30 to 40% reduction in colon cancer. And women also had reduced rates of ovarian cancer. So we're getting a lot more research and a lot more understanding of the health benefits of following a plant-based diet. So typical standard American diet is maybe one we think of where it's heavy on the meat and, you know, there's more processed foods. So incorporating more fruits and vegetables, more whole grains, that has so many health benefits, and we're really seeing the research coming out supporting that particular diet.
Well, and Oreos are vegetarian, right?
Exactly. That's why the plant-based is a really nice term, because it makes sure it also incorporates that health aspect to make sure that it's not just a substitution of, for example, dino chicken nuggets to your vegan chicken nuggets. They're both going to be processed foods that, of course, as parents are busy, it's not bad to include on occasion, but being a staple in the diet, want to look at incorporating more whole foods.
So can you talk a little more about the term that you used of well-planned?
So well-planned diet, we want to include variety in a plant-based diet. So for example, zinc is a nutrient where we want to make sure we're getting in a vegan diet because it is lower levels in plant-based foods. So if you're including a variety of foods, it's going to be much easier to make sure you're meeting your nutrient needs. You don't want to just think about if you're deciding to go plant-based or go vegan, you want to make sure you're not just taking away certain foods. You don't want to just take away milk and just take away meat and not consider how you're going to make up for those nutrients. So for example, calcium is incredibly important for growing children. Children as young as toddlers, they need about 700 milligrams. And when you get into teens, they're going to need almost as much, or they're going to need actually as much or even more the calcium, or they're going to have more of the calcium requirements than many adults. So of course toddlers are going to eat a lot less. So just relying on broccoli for your calcium source, for example, isn't going to be sufficient enough. So a cup of broccoli has about 60 milligrams of calcium. We want to make sure that we're getting good sources of calcium into our children's diets. You can get that again from tofu, or fortified soy milk is going to be a great way. So it's definitely, it's not necessarily hard to do it, but you just want to take those nutrients into consideration and make sure you're planning your children's diet appropriately.
So as a vegetarian, are people still worried about the whole complete versus incomplete protein? Or do they need to worry about, you know, mixing red beans and rice, for example? Or is there another way that you go about looking at the sources of nutrients?
That's a great question. So luckily they found that you don't need to pair those specific. So basically, you know, proteins are made up of essential amino acids, essential, non-essential. And basically we want to, so that came about that if a particular food is low in one of those essential amino acids, or one of the amino acids like methionine, that you want to, you know, do beans and rice together to make sure that it forms the complete protein. But you actually don't have to do that at the same meal. They debunked that. I believe what I had heard that it came about in a book in the 50s. I'm not quite certain on this, but, and then it sort of became a standard recommendation for vegetarian diets. But luckily they've gone back on that and found that there really wasn't evidence to support that. You don't have to pair them, but you know what? I think that by nature of planning out a meal, it kind of just happens naturally. So typically you're going to be doing beans with some type of grain because, you know, you're not really just going to be eating a bowl of beans anyway. So I think it sort of happens naturally, but you don't have to do it at the specific meal.
I think it's good to know that, yeah, like you said, you can mix proteins, but you don't, that's not part of the whole plan you have to do. Why do you find that kids are usually like enthusiastic or interested in starting this diet?
I think it depends for a variety of reasons, but the one that I see most often is the ethical aspect of it. It's the animal welfare. I think, you know, people learn about a little bit more about factory farming. And I find that, you know, for some reason at that age, you know, like I was talking about before, that adolescent age, I do hear a lot more. I have a lot more families coming to me just telling me that their children have decided to go that route. And it's funny because that was my story too. That's how I became vegetarian when I was 13. So that's really the main reason, you know, and then for families, like maybe the parents have decided to go more plant-based, or even perhaps they saw, you know, this is obviously more common now with the influx of documentaries that have come out. It's a lot of families coming to me and wanting to go that route. And I think that the most important thing is a lot of times people want to just change overnight. And I think that, you know, if you're an individual, that might work. But I think especially when you're involving your families, it's important to do it maybe more gradually. So focusing more on what foods that you can add or what dishes that you can add to your diet as opposed to what you're just going to be taking out. So, and that's kind of how I ended up going into more of a vegan route, was adding in it slowly into my diet. You know, with my daughter, when I found out she was allergic to eggs and milk, she was, you know, about 7-8 months old. So I was in a rush to make these changes. So I did it slowly and found there's so many different recipes that are really delicious. It was actually funny because I remember that before I was mostly vegan, that, you know, anytime a recipe turned bad, all I would do was just throw a bunch of cheese on it and instantly it was good. So I had to learn some strategies to cooking more plant-based. And I think that it does take time. So I think that people need to be, you know, kind with themselves. And, you know, especially when they're thinking about the kindness to the animals and the environment, that we also have to have kindness towards ourselves and, you know, maybe doing things gradually, like I said, and getting the kids involved in the process, like cooking and picking out ingredients, you know, getting kids to eat plant-based or even fruits and or maybe not fruits, but vegetables has been, you know, a struggle of parents for a very long time. So I think oftentimes when I'm working with parents, you know, if they're very concerned about the nutritional aspect, oftentimes I'm focusing, especially when we're talking about young children, on preventing picky eating and helping them work with their children to eat more variety. So it's really, of course, great to have this well-planned vegan diet, or a vegetarian diet, or any kind of diet for that matter that's healthy. But if they won't eat it, then, you know, it doesn't matter. So, but it's just, you know, it's a process with kids, regardless of their diet, to eat more vegetables and eat more whole grains. So oftentimes in a session or, you know, appointments with clients, I'm referring a lot to the Ellen Satter website and talk about a lot about the divisions of responsibility, and which if people aren't familiar with it, it's basically, you know, parents deciding what foods to offer, when and where, and children decide how much. So it helps make meal times a lot less stressful. You know, you want to make sure you're giving something to your child that they're going to eat, and then allowing them to get more exposed to different types of vegetables and whole grains. And it's a process. So, you know, I think that that's where sometimes a supplement, you know, can come in handy. But of course, you know, like I said, want to talk to your doctor, dietitian, because while we want to make sure we're focusing on getting adequate nutrition, we also want to build a healthy relationship to food. We also want to take the stress out of meal times, because any parent knows it can be a challenge to get your child to eat particular foods. Like I said, again, no matter what type of diet you're following.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So we haven't said anything about like organic or non-GMO. Is there anything of that that goes into the plant-based or vegetarian diet, or are they two completely different topics?
So I think that they are, that is really a choice that I think it's up to the family. I don't think that there's sufficient evidence on either side to make a wide claim on whether to include more organic or not include organic. The goal is really to include more fruits and vegetables, organic or not. So organic food can be, especially in particular seasons or in particular areas, can be so much more expensive. And you don't want to not eat fruits and vegetables because it's not organic. So I try as much as possible to not go into that. Of course, I get asked about that. So I really emphasize that the benefits of eating fruits and vegetables that are non-organic are gonna, there's just not sufficient evidence for avoiding or non-organic foods. So, and same thing with the GMOs. So I know actually this is something where I do see frequently in the vegan community, because a lot of people are concerned about soy, because most times soy can be genetically modified. So I tried to help dispel some of the myths about GMOs. And of course, we're still learning more about it. So again, it's hard to make a, you know, a recommendation based on the current research. So, you know, I think it's a personal choice. You can easily avoid GMO soy by choosing organic soy or tofu. But I think that that's really a personal and a family decision. But I do try to help dispel some of the myths, and or not even necessarily some of the myths, but some of the fear around those foods or those or topics.
Yeah, I think you make an excellent point. It's more value, more important to get the fruits and vegetables versus, like you said, if you can't afford the organic, to just not eat them. That's not as healthy as eating the one that may be non or maybe not be organic, but still is a fruit and vegetable that you're getting in your diet.
Exactly. And, you know, I'm actually very happy to see that there's a lot of dietitians now specializing in this area for vegan nutrition and plant-based nutrition, because it's definitely a growing area for dietitians. And I think it's really needed. Like I said, when I was trying to find, like I said, I was vegetarian and then went more vegan because of my daughter's allergies, and was just really surprised by how little information there was out there. So I'm so glad there's more dietitians entering this area, because I think that a lot of people that make, for example, an ethical choice to go vegan, they're turning to perhaps more, you know, some of the quote unquote nutrition experts that may not have degrees. And you'll see a lot, I feel like I see a lot more myths in these circles. I'm a part of a lot of different online communities for vegan parenting, and sort of just kind of listen in and see what, you know, people are saying. And so I think that not having information out there, so I'm just really glad that there's more dietitians entering this arena of plant-based nutrition, so that people and parents can get the correct and credible information.
So thinking about the kids that you work with, what are some foods that kids really like that almost surprises you, that you're like, I didn't think kids would like that?
Beans. I'm really surprised how many children do really like beans. And it really makes sense. I mean, even from a young age, beans are really soft, so it's easy to eat. And then you can just do so many things with beans. You can make veggie burgers. You know, you can just do such a wide variety of things. I mean, this is a dessert, but it's still fun doing like black bean brownies, different recipes that you can make with beans. But I'm surprised how well kids take to different legumes.
Yeah, my kids really like, of course, not vegan, ham and bean soup, but... And I was a little surprised by that too, because I was like, really?
Yeah, I know. Kids are actually very surprising sometimes with the foods they like.
What would be your words of advice to how to use this information we've talked about in their day-to-day life?
The key thing is really that, you know, most parents really want to do what's best for their children. I think that a lot of parents, you know, are, because there's doctors, dietitians, we're maybe not trained so much on the vegan nutrition. So because maybe if we don't have the knowledge for it, we get concerned about it. So I think it's met with sometimes with resistance, or people feel like it's met with resistance in the medical community. So I think it's really important to listen to parents and then just help meet them where they are. So and I think that where when the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics came out with that position statement, I think that that was really helpful. And I think that that was gave, I think, a lot of dietitians a much more confidence in working with vegan families to know that it is an appropriate diet. I think with children, of course, and rightfully so, we get very concerned because we want to make sure that they're getting proper nutrition. So I think knowing that a well-planned vegan and vegetarian diet is adequate, not only adequate, but it does have a lot of benefits, but it's important to, you know, be educated, make sure that they're getting their adequate nutrition.
So really just not assuming that it's not a good thing for kids, but really trying to find out how we can support that decision.
Exactly.
Great. So Jessica, my question I ask everybody is, what is your favorite food?
So I know I talk a lot about beans. There's many other plant-based proteins out there, but I do love lentils. They're easy to make. They don't have to do any soaking. And my daughter loves them. So I would say lentils are my favorite food.
All right. I didn't know you didn't have to soak beans.
Yes. Lentils are one of the only ones you do not have to soak. Yep. You can just cook it 20 minutes and done.
Good. That's a good tip there. Okay. Jessica, thank you so much for being on the podcast today. It was a pleasure to have you on the show. I know my listeners have learned a lot about the different aspects of vegetarianism, vegans, especially for kids. So if listeners want to connect with you, what's the best way to do that?
So my website is jessicaspirord.com. And then I'm also on Instagram, Facebook, at jessicaspirord.
Great. So guys, this has been another great episode of the Nutrition Experts Podcast, the podcast that is all about learning more so you can do more with nutrition in your life.
You've just listened to an episode of the Nutrition Experts Podcast. Be sure to get more information about this week's episode at www.nutritionexpertspodcast.com. Tune in next time for another great conversation with a nutrition expert and expand your personal knowledge in the field of nutrition, one conversation at a time.